Hey, good to see you all. Welcome to my channel and please like, share and subscribe my channel. So let's start. Chapter 1. I was born on the 8th of January 1942, exactly 300 years after the death of Galileo. However, I estimate that about 200,000 other babies were also born that day. I don't know whether any of them were later interested in astronomy. I was born in Oxford, even though my parents were living in London. This was because Oxford was a good place to be born during the Second World War. The Germans had an agreement that they would not bomb Oxford and Cambridge, in return for the British not bombing Heidelberg and Göttingen. It is a pity that this civilized sort of arrangement couldn't have been extended to more cities. My father came from Yorkshire. His grandfather, my great-grandfather, had been a wealthy farmer. He had bought too many farms and had gone bankrupt in the agricultural depression at the beginning of this century. This left my father's parents badly off, but they managed to send him to Oxford, where he studied medicine. He then went into research in tropical medicine. He went out to East Africa in 1937. When the war began, he made an overland journey across Africa to get a ship back to England, where he volunteered for military service. He was told, however, that he was more valuable in medical research. My mother was born in Glasgow, the second child of seven of a family doctor. The family moved south to Devon when she was 12. Like my father's family, hers was not well off. Nevertheless, they managed to send my mother to Oxford. After Oxford, she had various jobs, including that of inspector of taxes, which she did not like. She gave that up to become a secretary. That was how she met my father in the early years of the war. We lived in Highgate, North London. My sister Mary was born 18 months after me. I'm told I did not welcome her arrival. All through our childhood there was a certain tension between us, fed by the narrow difference in our ages. In our adult life, however, this tension has disappeared, as we have gone different ways. She became a doctor, which pleased my father. My younger sister, Philippa, was born when I was nearly 5 and was able to understand what was happening. I can remember looking forward to her arrival so that there would be 3 of us to play games. She was a very intense and perceptive child. I always respected her judgment and opinions. My brother Edward came much later, when I was 14, so he hardly entered my childhood at all. He was very different from the other 3 children, being completely non-academic and non-intellectual. It was probably good for us. He was a rather difficult child, but one couldn't help liking him. My earliest memory is of standing in the nursery of Byron House in Highgate and crying my head off. All around me, children were playing with what seemed like wonderful toys. I wanted to join in, but I was only 2½, and this was the first time I had been left with people I didn't know. I think my parents were rather surprised at my reaction, because I was their first child and they had been following child development textbooks that said that children ought to start making social relationships at 2. But they took me away after that awful morning and didn't send me back to Byron House for another 1½. At that time, during and just after the war, Highgate was an area in which a number of scientific and academic people lived. In another country they would have been called intellectuals, but the English have never admitted to having any intellectuals. All these parents sent their children to Byron House School, which was a very progressive school for those times. I remember complaining to my parents that they weren't teaching me anything. They didn't believe in what was then the accepted way of drilling things into you. Instead, you were supposed to learn to read without realizing you were being taught. In the end, I did learn to read, but not until the fairly late age of 8. My sister Philippa was taught to read by more conventional methods and could read by the age of 4. But then, she was definitely brighter than me. We lived in a tall, narrow Victorian house, which my parents had bought very cheaply during the war, when everyone thought London was going to be bombed flat. In fact, a V-2 rocket landed a few houses away from ours. I was away with my mother and sister at the time, but my father was in the house. Fortunately, he was not hurt, and the house was not badly damaged. But for years there was a large bomb site down the road, on which I used to play with my friend Howard, who lived 3 doors the other way. Howard was a revelation to me because his parents weren't intellectuals like the parents of all the other children I knew. He went to the council school, not Byron House, and he knew about football and boxing, sports that my parents wouldn't have dreamed of following. Another early memory was getting my first train set. Toys were not manufactured during the war, at least not for the home market. But I had a passionate interest in model trains. My father tried making me a wooden train, but that didn't satisfy me, as I wanted something that worked. So my father got a second-hand clockwork train, repaired it with a soldering iron, and gave it to me for Christmas when I was nearly three. That train didn't work very well. But my father went to America just after the war, and when he came back on the Queen Mary, he brought my mother some nylons, which were not obtainable in Britain at that time. He brought my sister Mary a doll that closed its eyes when you laid it down. And he brought me an American train, complete with a cow catcher and a figure of eight track. I can still remember my excitement as I opened the box. Clockwork trains were all very well, but what I really wanted were electric trains. I used to spend hours watching a model railway club layout in Crouch End, near Highgate. I dreamed about electric trains. Finally, when both my parents were away somewhere, I took the opportunity to draw out of the post office bank all the very modest amount of money that people had given me on special occasions like my christening. I used the money to buy an electric train set, but frustratingly enough, it didn't work very well. Nowadays, we know about consumer rights. I should have taken the set back and demanded that the shop or manufacturer replace it, but in those days the attitude was that it was a privilege to buy something, and it was just your bad luck if it turned out to be faulty. So I paid for the electric motor of the engine to be serviced, but it never worked very well. Later on, in my teens, I built model aeroplanes and boats. I was never very good with my hands, but I did this with my school friend John McLenican, who was much better and whose father had a workshop in their house. My aim was always to build working models that I could control. I didn't care what they looked like. I think it was the same drive that led me to invent a series of very complicated games with another school friend, Roger Fernioff. There was a manufacturing game, complete with factories in which units of different colors were made, roads and railways on which they were carried, and a stock market. There was a war game, played on a board of 4,000 squares, and even a feudal game, in which each player was a whole dynasty, with a family tree. I think these games, as well as the trains, boats, and aeroplanes, came from an urge to know how things worked and to control them. Since I began my PhD, this need has been met by my research into cosmology. If you understand how the universe operates, in a way you control. In 1950, my father's place of work moved from Hampstead, near Highgate, to the newly constructed National Institute for Medical Research in Mill Hill, on the northern edge of London. Rather than travel out from Highgate, it seemed more sensible to move out of London and travel into town. My parents therefore bought a house in the cathedral city of St. Albans, about 10 miles north of Mill Hill and 20 miles north of London. It was a large Victorian house of some elegance and character. My parents were not very well off when they bought it, and they had to have quite a lot of work done on it before we could move in. Thereafter, my father, like the Yorkshireman he was, refused to pay for any further repairs. Instead, he did his best to keep it going and keep it painted, but it was a big house and he was not very skilled in such matters. The house was solidly built, however, so it withstood this neglect. My parents sold it in 1985, when my father was very ill. He died in 1986. I saw it recently. It didn't seem that any more work had been done on it, but it still looked much the same. The house had been designed for a family with servants, and in the pantry there was an indicator board that showed which room the bell had been rung from. Of course we didn't have servants, but my first bedroom was a little L-shaped room that must have been a maid's room. I asked for it at the suggestion of my cousin Sarah, who was slightly older than me and whom I greatly admired. She said that we could have great fun there. One of the attractions of the room was that one could climb from the window out onto the roof of the bicycle shed and thence to the ground. Sarah was the daughter of my mother's eldest sister, Janet, who had trained as a doctor and was married to a psychoanalyst. They lived in a rather similar house in Harpenden, a village 5 miles further north. They were one of the reasons we moved to St. Albans. It was a great bonus to me to be near Sarah, and I frequently went on the bus to Harpenden. St. Albans itself stood next to the remains of the ancient Roman city of Verulamium, which had been the most important Roman settlement in Britain after London. In the Middle Ages it had had the richest monastery in Britain. It was built around the shrine of St. Alban, a Roman centurion who is said to have been the first person in Britain to be executed for the Christian faith. All that remained of the abbey was a very large and rather ugly abbey church and the old abbey gateway building, which was now part of St. Alban's school, where I later went. St. Alban's was a somewhat stodgy and conservative place compared with Highgate or Harpenden. My parents made hardly any friends there. In part this was their own fault, as they were naturally rather solitary, particularly my father. But it also reflected a different kind of population. Certainly none of the parents of my school friends in St. Albans could be described as intellectuals. In Highgate our family had seemed fairly normal, but in St. Albans I think we were definitely regarded as eccentric. This perception was increased by the behavior of my father, who cared nothing for appearances if this allowed him to save money. His family had been very poor when he was young, and it had left a lasting impression on him. He couldn't bear to spend money on his own comfort, even when, in later years, he could afford to. He refused to put in central heating, even though he felt the cold badly. Instead, he would wear several sweaters and a dressing gown on top of his normal clothes. He was, however, very generous to other people. In the 1950s he felt we couldn't afford a new car, so he bought a pre-war London taxi, and he and I built an Essen hut as a garage. The neighbors were outraged, but they couldn't stop us. Like most boys, I felt a need to conform, and I was embarrassed by my parents. But it never worried them. When we first came to St. Albans, I was sent to the high school for girls, which despite its name took boys up to the age of 10. After I had been there one term, however, my father took one of his almost yearly visits to Africa, this time for a rather longer period of about 4 months. My mother didn't feel like being left all that time, so she took my two sisters and me to visit her school friend Beryl, who was married to the poet Robert Graves. They lived in a village called De, on the Spanish island of Mallorca. This was only 5 years after the war, and Spain's dictator, Francisco Franco, who had been an ally of Hitler and Mussolini, was still in power. In fact, he remained in power for another 2 decades. Nevertheless, my mother, who had been a member of the Young Communist League before the war, went with 3 young children by boat and train to Mallorca. We rented a house in Du and had a wonderful time. I shared a tutor with Robert's son, William. This tutor was a protege of Robert and was more interested in writing a play for the Edinburgh Festival than in teaching us. He therefore set us to read a chapter of the Bible each day and write a piece on it. The idea was to teach us the beauty of the English language. We got through all of Genesis and part of Exodus before I left. One of the main things I was taught from this was not to begin a sentence with "and." I pointed out that most sentences in the Bible began with "and," but I was told that English had changed since the time of King James. In that case, I argued, why make us read the Bible? But it was in vain. Robert Graves was very keen on the symbolism and mysticism in the Bible at that time. When we got back from Mallorca, I was sent to another school for a year, and then I took the so-called 11-plus examination. This was an intelligence test that was taken at that time by all children who wanted state education. It has now been abolished, mainly because a number of middle-class children failed it and were sent to non-academic schools. But I tended to do much better on tests and examinations than I did on coursework, so I passed and got a free place at the local St. Albans school. When I was 13, my father wanted me to try for Westminster School, one of the main public, that is to say, private, schools. At that time there was a sharp division in education along class lines. My father felt that his lack of poise and connections had led to him being passed over in favor of people of less ability but more social graces. Because my parents were not well off, I would have to win a scholarship. I was ill at the time of the scholarship examination, however, and did not take it. Instead, I remained at St. Albans School. I got an education there that was as good as, if not better than, that I would have had at Westminster. I have never found that my lack of social graces has been a hindrance. English education at that time was very hierarchical. Not only were schools divided into academic and non-academic, but the academic schools were further divided into A, B and C streams. This worked well for those in the A stream but not so well for those in the B stream, and badly for those in the C stream, who got discouraged. I was put in the A stream, based on the results of the 11+. But after the first year, everyone who came below 20th in the class was put down to the B stream. This was a tremendous blow to their self-confidence, from which some never recovered. In my first two terms at S. R. Albans, I came 24th and 23rd, but in my third term I came 18th. So I just escaped. I was never more than about halfway up the class. It was a very bright class, my classwork was very untidy, and my handwriting was the despair of my teachers. But my classmates gave me the nickname Einstein, so presumably they saw signs of something better. When I was 12, one of my friends bet another friend a bag of sweets that I would never come to anything. I don't know if this bet was ever settled and, if so, which way it was decided. I had 6 or 7 close friends, most of whom I'm still in touch with. We used to have long discussions and arguments about everything from radio-controlled models to religion, and from parapsychology to physics. One of the things we talked about was the origin of the universe and whether it required a god to create it and set it going. I had heard that light from distant galaxies was shifted towards the red end of the spectrum and this was supposed to indicate that the universe was expanding. A shift to the blue would have meant it was contracting, but I was sure there must be some other reason for the red shift. Maybe light got tiled, and more red, on its way to us. An essentially unchanging and everlasting universe seemed so much more natural. It was only after about 2 years of PhD research that I realized I had been wrong. When I came to the last 2 years of school, I wanted to specialize in mathematics and physics. There was an inspirational maths teacher, Mr. Titter, and the school had just built a new maths room, which the maths set had as their classroom. But my father was very much against it. He thought there wouldn't be any jobs for mathematicians except as teachers. He would really have liked me to do medicine, but I showed no interest in biology, which seemed to me to be too descriptive and not sufficiently fundamental. It also had a rather low status at school. The brightest boys did mathematics and physics, the less bright did biology. My father knew I wouldn't do biology, but he made me do chemistry and only a small amount of mathematics. He felt this would keep my scientific options open. I'm now a professor of mathematics, but I have not had any formal instruction in mathematics since I left St. Albans School at the age of 17. I have had to pick up what mathematics I know as I went along. I used to supervise undergraduates at Cambridge and keep 1 week ahead of them in the course. My father was engaged in research in tropical diseases, and he used to take me around his laboratory in Mill Hill. I enjoyed this, especially looking through microscopes. He also used to take me into the insect house, where he kept mosquitoes infected with tropical diseases. This worried me, because there always seemed to be a few mosquitoes flying around loose. He was very hardworking and dedicated to his research. He had a bit of a chip on his shoulder because he felt that other people who were not so good but who had the right background and connections had got ahead of him. He used to warn me against such people. But I think physics is a bit different from medicine. It doesn't matter what school you went to or to whom you are related. It matters what you do. I was always very interested in how things operated and used to take them apart to see how they worked, but I was not so good at putting them back together again. My practical abilities never matched up to my theoretical inquiries. My father encouraged my interest in science, and he even coached me in mathematics until I got to a stage beyond his knowledge. With this background, and my father's job, I took it as natural that I would go into scientific research. In my early years I didn't differentiate between one kind of science and another. But from the age of 13 or 14, I knew I wanted to do research in physics because it was the most fundamental science. This was despite the fact that physics was the most boring subject at school because it was so easy and obvious. Chemistry was much more fun because unexpected things, like explosions, kept happening. But physics and astronomy offered the hope of understanding where we came from and why we were here. I wanted to fathom the far depths of the universe. Maybe I have succeeded to a small extent, but there's still plenty I want to know.